Good morning, everybody. Has anybody here ever been lost?
Yes.
I bet no man in here has ever gotten lost. I know y'all heard about that. So if anybody's ever gotten lost, it was a woman. Because only a woman will admit it. Men will never admit they're lost. And you know, it's bad, but men will ask for directions. Always heard this word. You go up there and then it's up there and you can't miss it. Right? And whenever I hear that, I realize things are about to get bad. And if they tell me you can't miss it, then I know without a doubt I'm going to miss it.
Had to be a busy little town. They Rome sent out a tax
collection. Everybody had to come to that little town and pay their taxes. And we see that Christmas came to Bethlehem that morning. It came, and that innkeeper, he missed Christmas. Although it was right in front of him, he missed Christmas. But I have to ask you, why did the innkeeper miss Christmas? Well, I'm sure that innkeeper had a lot going on. Hey, he was a business person. He had a business to run. He had obligations to take care of. And he was definitely a busy man. Matter of fact, he was so busy that the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ appeared before him and he missed it. He just flat out missed Christmas. I just wonder how many of us get so busy in our lives these days that we miss out on Jesus Christ. I mean, we can be busy doing good things and still miss out on Jesus Christ. Do not this holiday season miss out on Jesus. Because Jesus is the reason for this holiday season. I'm sure this innkeeper was a great guy. And evidently he ran a great inn because it was plumb full. Everybody wanted to stay at the innkeeper's place. But I just wonder if the innkeeper might have did something different if he'd have thought about it. You reckon the innkeeper could have maybe asked somebody if they'd be willing to give up their room so this pregnant lady about to give birth could have her child? I don't know. He probably could have, but he didn't. Wonder how many times we could go out of our way at some point in time. How many times we could just stop what we're doing even though it's so important to us and to the world. It can be mighty important, but what would it mean if we would give up some time for Jesus? What if the innkeeper would have given up a little time? What if the innkeeper would have said, look, you know what? I can't find anybody to give you their bed. How about if I give you my bed? What a difference that would have made in the innkeeper's life. Matter of fact, if that would have happened, we would have probably knew his name and a whole lot more about him. But as it stands, all we know is the innkeeper had no room at the inn. I don't want to be the innkeeper that had no room for Jesus. I want to make room for Jesus in my heart this year, this day, and my whole life. Do you have room in your heart for Jesus Christ this morning? That's what I'm asking you. Amen. Will you make room for Jesus Christ this holiday season? Hey, if you're going to make room for Jesus now, you may have to put some other things aside to make room for him. You know that? If you're going to make room for Jesus, you may have to prioritize some other things. And some things you may find out they ain't quite as important as what you thought. I bet that innkeeper thought that inn was the most important thing in this world. And he did everything he could to keep that inn going. But you know what? Peter just took a little time and put that inn on the back burner and just showed a little kindness to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Lord knows what might have happened to him. He could have influenced people. He could have had a great influence on all kinds of people in the world. But no, he missed it. It was right there. I mean, I'm sure the shepherds and the wise men would have told him, you can't miss it. It's Jesus. But you know what? Don't let anybody fool you. You can miss Jesus. You can miss out on what he has for your life. You can miss out on salvation. You can miss out on blessings. You can miss out on life and life more abundantly if you don't make room for Jesus Christ. So let me ask you, will you make room for Jesus this year? Will you make room for him? I plan on making room for him. And you know, if I have to get rid of some other things to make room for Jesus, that's okay, because that just might be what has to happen. Sometimes we have to clear out a little space for Jesus, because in this world, we let too many other things take the place of Jesus. You know, we may have to cut back on a few hours at work. We may have to cut back on a few lattes. We may have to cut back on a little fishing time. I'm preaching to myself. We may have to cut back on some things to make room for Jesus. But let me tell you, you will never be sorry that you made room for Jesus Christ.
Amen. Amen.
Oh, if that innkeeper would have just had a little more room. But he didn't. He didn't have no more room. So he had to make room if he wanted Jesus to stay there. And let me tell you, I know you ain't got no room in your life. Your life is full, just like mine. And praise God for it. I've got a full life. But let me tell you, I don't care how full your life is with worldly things. If it ain't got Jesus in it, it's empty and void and of non-effect. Amen. You got to have Jesus in your life or you ain't got nothing. What did John say to the church? He said, oh, you think you're rich and beautiful and great, but really what you are is poor and miserable and blind and wretched because you don't have Jesus.
Amen.
You got to have Jesus or you ain't got nothing. It all starts with Jesus Christ. It all started with the inn that was too full. Hey, your inn may be full, but what you got to do is make room for Jesus. You got to make a choice. I'm going to choose to make room in my life for Jesus. I may have to clear out some junk. I may have to get rid of some things to make room. But let me tell you, Jesus Christ is worth it.
Amen.
It's worth it to make room for Jesus. Oh my gosh, I just can't imagine what that innkeeper thought when people come back and told him. Remember that little baby? He turned away a pregnant woman. That's the king of the universe. And all he wanted was a warm bed. Can you imagine how he felt? Can't miss it. But he missed it. Well, let me tell you something. If you read on to verse 8, you'll find some people that were mighty busy. They was real busy. I mean, they had a hard job. They were not well respected. And they were living out in the open field, didn't have a roof over their head. But let me tell you, when Jesus came, they made time to go find Jesus. And they were blessed. The Bible says, and there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock. And it says, and lo, the angel of the Lord come upon them. And the glory of the Lord shone round about them. And they were sore afraid. Sore afraid. We don't use that word much anymore. But let me tell you what sore afraid means. It means they were scared to death when them angels come upon them in power and glory. They were scared. It humbled them. I'm sure they cowered down and they didn't know what to do. Let me tell you, when the Spirit of the Lord comes upon you, you will humble yourself. He will humble you. I don't care where you are. If you're driving down the road, if you're sitting on your couch, He'll drive you to your knees. And you will be humbled by the Spirit of God. I was talking to a friend of mine. And I told him how. I said, you know, one of the most saddest things to me is when I think about all the people who have never experienced the consuming power of the Holy Spirit. All the people that have never had the Holy Ghost just come upon them in fullness and power and drive them to their knees. Oh, I feel sorry for you if you're one of those people. But let me tell you, the Spirit of God wants to come upon you. The Spirit of God wants to be with you. But you've got to receive Him in your life. You've got to say, here am I, like Samuel did. You've got to say, here am I, God, like all the others did, like Moses said, like Abram said. Here am I, God. Let me feel your presence. Show me your glory, Lord. Do you want to see the glory of the Lord this morning, church?
Amen.
Amen. I do too. I want to see the glory of the Lord on this place shining down from heaven. And we can see it. God wants to show it to us. He showed it to them back on that day. He showed it to some shepherds. Hey, he could have went and picked some really rich, fine-dressed people, but he didn't. He went and picked poor, old, miserable country redneck. I bet them shepherds were rednecks. Oh, my gosh. I bet there's a bunch of rednecks. That's all they were. They were Bethlehem rednecks. People didn't respect them. That's kind of rough around the edges. And I'm sure they probably didn't dress real good. They probably didn't I knew in my heart they were just some regular old unrespected country folks, and the Spirit of the Lord went to them. Why? Why wouldn't he go to some educated people? Why wouldn't he go to a rich, well-dressed person? Because God is no respecter of persons. He can use anybody, but let me tell you, he'd rather use you and me, all of us, because he uses the lowly things of this world to confound the wise. He uses the base things, the humble things of this world to bring down the proud. Hallelujah for that. That makes me excited. You know why? Because that means he can use me. He can use you. He can use each and every one of us to accomplish his purpose here on earth. Oh, them old shepherds, they rejoiced, didn't they? That's what the word says. An angel talked to them and told them where to go. And I never was a Baptist. The group of angels come down and they say, well, you better go see Jesus. They say, all right, well, we better form a committee about this and have a business meeting and we'll get back to you and see if we can make it. But they didn't have no business meeting. They didn't consult the elders. What did they do? They instantly sought after Jesus. Let me tell you, if God is calling you this morning, you don't have to seek out the elders. If God is calling you this morning, we ain't got to hold no meeting and vote you in, because God is letting you in right now. The door is open. He will let you in this morning. He will save your soul. And what to say? And it came to pass, as the angels were going away, verse 15 says, and the shepherds said one to another, let us now go into this Bethlehem and see the thing which has come to pass. Oh, yes. And then verse 20, they went and saw. They went and saw the Lord. And it says in verse 20, and the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen as it was told unto them. Let me tell you, if you come into the presence of the Almighty God, when you leave, you ain't going to leave in one way, and that's praising and glorifying God. You know why more people don't praise God and glorify God? It's because they ain't been in the presence of God. You get in the presence of God, you can't help but to praise God. You can't help but to give him glory. But the problem is, we're scared to come into his presence. Because he sees us just like we are, don't he? He sees all our warts and all our hair and all our ugliness and all of our sin. And that scares us because we want to hide all that stuff. But you can't hide it from God. And that makes us not want to come into his presence sometimes. But let me tell you something. God ain't the type of God that wants you to come into his presence so he can smack you and punish you and beat you down. My God is a forgiving God. My God wants you to come into his presence so he can renew you, so he can refresh you, so he can give you a fresh anointing upon your life. He wants to renew your soul and forgive you of your sins. And that is why we come into his presence. We need not fear God unless we're doing wrong. Then you need to fear him. But even if you've done wrong, if you ask him to forgive you, he will forgive your sins. And they will be cast as far as the east is from the west. Oh, he's a loving God. He's a forgiving God. He's a renewing God. And what better time to receive all of that from him than Christmas time? Yeah, those shepherds left rejoicing because Christmas came to them. And they found him. They couldn't miss him. They couldn't miss them angels up in the sky. They couldn't miss that baby Jesus. And why? How did it all start? What allowed them to be able to find Jesus in the first place? Even though they had tremendously busy lives, they were all tied up. They were tied up from now till the cows come home, or till the sheep come home, I guess I should say. They were busy. They were busy as a one-legged man in a butt-kicking contest. They were just busy. But you know what? you might have to put some things on the back burner and put Jesus on the front burner. Anybody here willing to put Jesus on the front burner today?
Amen.
I'm willing. I'm willing to put him on the front burner. And then I just want to show y'all one more thing in Matthew. Matthew chapter 2. Christmas came to the innkeeper and he missed it. Christmas came to the shepherds. They couldn't miss it. It was right there. They made time for Jesus and they were blessed. Well, let me tell you, in Matthew chapter 2, Christmas came to the wise men. Christmas came to the wise men. These were some wise men. Everybody wants, who in the world are these people? Because obviously they were not Jewish people, because they were not from Jerusalem. They were from the east. And what was in the east? Well, to the east was Babylon. And so what most people believe is these are some people that Daniel probably influenced, because there were some magi back in Daniel's time. And so he probably influenced these people and told them about Jesus. But be that as it may, ever who they were, I know one thing about it. When Christmas came, they noticed it because they were looking for it. They were looking up in the sky for a sign. They were looking for it. They knew something about it, and they were looking for Jesus Christ to come. And so when they looked up in the sky, and behold, it was a star up in the sky. Now, it says they followed that star, and this is a real star too. It's a scientific fact that this Bethlehem star was real. Now I can't explain to you how it happened, but I know when two stars converge, Venus and Jupiter, every now and then, every couple thousand years, they converge and it looks like one big star. And the way it works is when it converges, they come together and makes one star, and it almost looks like they stop. They don't stop, but it looks like it stops right there close to the horizon. And it just stands still. But what it is they're so close together you can't see them. And they eventually move apart. Now that's not normal, because it only happens every couple thousand years. But you know what? Them wise men, they were looking up at the sky and they said, look, that don't look right. That's something different right there. That's a star right there that I ain't never seen before. Something's different about that. And they did a little research, because I think Daniel had told them a little something about Jesus and his coming. Because Daniel knew stuff that he wasn't even supposed to know. He knew stuff that he had to seal up and couldn't even tell. And I believe he revealed some of that to these wise men. And they seen that star and they said, look, I'll tell you what. I ain't never seen that star, but I believe that star means that Jesus is coming. And I believe if we follow that star, we'll find Jesus. And lo and behold, what'd they do? Followed that star, didn't they? Followed that star and wound up finding that little baby Jesus. That star was right there, right over here in Bethlehem. Christmas came to the wise men. They didn't miss it. Why didn't they miss it? Because they were looking for it. They were expecting it, I believe. They were just waiting for it. Let me tell you, are you looking for Jesus this morning? Did you come into this place looking for Jesus Christ? Because I'm going to tell you something, and you might not take this the right way, and it may not come out the right way. But let me tell you, if you come here and you weren't looking for Jesus Christ, you come here for the wrong reason. But I'm glad you're here anyway, because I believe I can show you how to find him before you leave here. You know, the reason we come here is because we are seeking Jesus, just like those wise men. We're looking at the stars in the sky, and they tell of his glory. Oh, we see the ocean, how it stops at the beach right there, and that they declare his glory. I'm telling you, all the heavens and all the earth declare the glory of the Lord. And we got to come here expecting Jesus to speak to us this morning. Did you come here expecting that Jesus was going to speak to you this morning? I did. I come here expecting that. And if you didn't, then why didn't you? Why would you not expect it? This is God's house. This is God's people. This is God's word. The only way he won't speak to you is if you won't have it, is if you won't hear it, if you won't open your heart to receive it. Otherwise, God is going to speak to you this morning. Because God's word accomplish the purpose wherein it was sent out to do. I believe that. Do you? I believe it because the Bible says it. Not because I said it. I believe it because it's in the Bible. And I believe every word of the Bible. See, them wise men, they were seeking him. I remember we've seen all the bumper stickers. And it's true, wise men still seek him today. We still seek him, but let me tell you, what I like about this is, let me see if I can find the verse. Verse 12 of chapter 2. It says, and they give little baby Jesus their gifts and stuff. And it says, and being warned of God in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed into their own country another way. That don't sound like much to y'all, probably. But it sounds like a lot to me. See, when these wise men, they were looking for something. They were looking for a sign. And God gave them a sign. It was that star. But the sign wasn't really the star. The sign was what the star pointed to. The sign was Jesus. Oh, they were looking for that sign. And when they found it, they followed that sign and they found Jesus. They come into contact with that baby Jesus. Oh, they come in contact with Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And it says they left a different way than they came. I'm telling you, children of God, when you come in contact with Jesus, you're going to leave a different way than the way you come. I believe you're going to leave here this morning a different way than when you come in here. If you let the Word of God have full effect on you, you're going to leave here a different way than when you come in, because the Word of God is going to have its effect upon you. I pray that I can leave here a different way. I pray that you'll leave here a different way than the way we come here. And I ain't saying we come here in no bad way. But when you come in contact with Jesus, you're going to leave in a different way, a better way, a true and pure way. That way is Jesus Christ. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh before God except by me. And if you're going to come before God today, you're going to have to do it through Jesus Christ. There's no other way to get to God. There's no other way to get to heaven. No shortcuts. Some people say all roads lead to God, and that's just a lie. As a matter of fact, the Bible says that straight and narrow is that one road. Them roads that lead off, them big wide roads, they carry you to a different place, a warm place, a whole lot warmer climate than I want to go to. Yeah, so I try to stay on that straight, that little bitty path that's hard to find. Not many find it. But I can show you the way today. I can get you on that little path if you're willing. Because I can tell you who beat down that path for you. His name is Jesus. He beat that path down for you with his body and his blood. And he's waiting for you today, right now. Now, I just want to tell you. Them wise men were looking up in the sky, waiting for a sign. I'm going to tell you, everybody here, you better be looking up in the sky too, because there's a sign coming. That sign is going to be a cloud in the sky, and it's going to be Jesus coming, because Jesus Christ is coming back. He's not coming back as a little bitty baby in a manger. He's coming back as a righteous judge on a war horse. He's coming to take his church away and to start the judgment of those who have rejected Jesus. But praise God, there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. We don't have to die. You know, I take such great satisfaction in my hope that I may not have to die. You know, Christians are the only ones that can say that. I may not have to die. Because Jesus could come back at any time. And if Jesus Christ comes back right now, I will not have to die. The Bible tells me my body will be changed in the twinkling of an eye. And I'll be gathered up together in the clouds to be with Jesus forever. Amen. That's my hope. Because I have Jesus Christ as my Lord. So when I look up at that sky, I'm looking for a sign. I'm looking for that sign. For them clouds to break open and Jesus Christ to be coming for me. And for my brothers and sisters in Christ. Do you have that hope? Can you say that? Can you say with me, even so, Lord Jesus, come.
Amen.
I'm glad some people say amen, because a lot of people saying, oh man.
I hope so.
people saying, oh man, I hope you don't come today because I ain't ready. Everybody wants to go to heaven, but nobody wants to die to get there, right? A lot of people don't even want to ask Jesus in their heart to get there. That's the problem. There's no other way. No other way to get there if you don't have Jesus in your heart as your Lord and Savior. When he comes back for his church, you're going to be left behind. And it's going to be a bad time. Anybody ever read about that in the Bible? It's a bad time, man. Amen. But I don't want to be no part of that. I want to be with Jesus. But whether he takes me or whether I might be a witness. Maybe I got to be a witness for him. I don't know. But whatever it is, I know Jesus Christ will be with me. And every step I take, he'll take that step with me. So I'll leave you with this. I just want to tell you this right here. If somebody tells you, you can't miss it, don't believe them. Because you can miss it. You can miss it. You can miss it today. You can miss it tomorrow on Christmas Day. You miss Christmas altogether. But you don't have to. You don't have to miss it. You don't have to miss a thing. If you will make room for Jesus, if you'll make time for Jesus, and if you will look for Jesus, you will find the true meaning of Christmas. Christmas is coming to you. Please don't miss it. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we come to you again, Lord, and we're just so grateful and thankful for your Son and everything that Christmas represents. I thank you for each and every person here, for each and every family represented. And I pray just a special blessing on each family that's here this morning. Lord, I pray you reach down from heaven and just lay your hands upon them this Christmas season, Lord. I know there are families here that are having conflicts and struggles, Lord. I know that there's families here that are not speaking right to each other, Lord. I know there's people here that ain't talked to their mamas and daddies, and there's mamas and daddies that ain't talked to their children, Lord. And I just pray that you would intercede, Lord. I plead the blood of Jesus over each and every one of these families. And I pray that every what problems they have, you would work it out. And that your hands would be upon them in such a mighty way that they would forget about themselves and just think about you. Act like you. We want to emulate you. And if we do that, what we'll be emulating is forgiveness and love and grace and mercy. We'll be conduits of that flowing out to our families. Also, this holiday season, I pray you give us boldness to witness to our families. There's no greater time of the year to witness to our families than Christmas time, because we're already acknowledging it's the birth of Jesus. Give us boldness to bring our families to Christ. Lord, now we just pray that if there's one here within the sound of my voice right now, Lord, I want to speak to the ones that are unsure, don't know 100%. They can't say 100% that they're going to heaven if they die right now. It's to that very person, all of those people, I pray right now that you would just surrender to the Lord Jesus. I pray if you don't know for sure, you would pray with me right now. Just pray these simple words. Dear Lord Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. I know I fall short of your glory. But Lord, I need a Savior. I pray you would just come into my heart and save me. I don't understand. And I know I don't have to understand. All I have to do is believe that you're able to do it. So Lord, come into my heart and save me. Let me leave here a different way than I came. Lord, I'm speaking also to the one who is backslidden and not been living to you, Lord, like they should. And Lord, I pray that they would say this prayer. And Lord, I know that I failed you. Lord, I just pray that you would forgive me all my sins and accept me back into the fold, Lord. Just take me back into love. Cleanse my sin. Make me new again. Give me back the desire to love you, the desire to serve you, the desire to be yours. Yeah, I just believe, Lord God, that You're going to intercede on families, Lord, and I just thank you in advance for all these things that you're going to do this holiday season. But I thank you most of all for your Son, Jesus Christ. Without him, we don't have him. So, Lord, be with us now, in Jesus' name. Amen.